So with that, our next speaker is Dr. Mathias Zahniser. He's the eldest of the four children of Howard and Alice Zahniser. The other siblings of Howard and Alice are Esther, Karen, and Ed. This is Matt's second time being a featured speaker at a ceremony co-sponsored by Friends of Allegheny Wilderness, honoring his father, the first being the historical marker and dedication in 13 years ago in Tionesta. Matt earned his PhD from Johns Hopkins University in 1973. He was a professor at Central Michigan University from 1971 to 1978, Greenville College from 1978 through 1983, and at the Asbury Theological Seminary from 1983 through 2000. He's currently a scholar in residence at Greenville College, a position he's held since 2007. And I might add that Matt was actually, along with Mr. and Mrs. Zahniser, on that 1937 canoe trip down the Allegheny River, although Mr. and Mrs. Zahniser weren't aware of it. Matt, I'd like to introduce Matt.
That was good. Visiting my grandmother in Tionesta, where both my parents are now buried, I had the privilege of playing on the Tionesta Little League baseball team. I liked especially that we traveled to other towns, such as Tiyute and West Hickory. It was like the big leagues, you know, traveling from town to town for a suburban boy. I love the Allegheny River, the Tionesta Hills, fishing in Tionesta Creek and in the river. Possibly most of all, Kilmer's General Store with its case full of hunting knives. But my experience in the island wilderness of the Allegheny River goes back further, as Kirk has suggested. I was in utero when in 1937, now listen carefully, Alice and Howard Zahniser floated down the Allegheny from Olean to Tionesta in a canoe that Howard named the Alice and Howard. Listen carefully, Alice and Howard. Does that sound like Alice and Howard? On January 10, 1938, I, their first child, met them for the first time. They named me Allison Howard Mathias Zahniser. Was I named after a canoe? My father obviously loved puns. For example, he would refer to my wife's university, Penn State University, as my alma mater-in-law. Now, in 2007, I, my son David, and his wife Rachel joined Kirk Johnson and a host of others for a paddle down the beautiful Allegheny through the Allegheny Islands wilderness area. This was commemorating that trip on which I traveled without being able to see any of the scenery. Now listen, what a bookends for a life of love for Tionesta and the Alleghenies, from gestation to commemoration. Now, something about my father, Howard Zahniser, as a person, and then to make a plea that Zahni, as they called him, would have made had he been here. Dad wanted us siblings, in the summer especially, to play together as a family, and forbade our playing, our going to play with other children after supper. His reason? Family solidarity. It worked. We had family solidarity. Here's what our family friend and Wilderness Society council member Harvey Broom said about us siblings in a letter to Mom and us in 1965. Never, he said, have I seen four children in one family so companionable, so interesting, so full of life. My parents saw that we had badminton, croquet, basketball backboard on the garage, and other equipment. Dad was a stern disciplinarian, but he was also a thoughtful mentor. Here's a window into his parenting. At age seven, Mathias, was invited by older boys in our neighborhood to play in a tackle football game on the afternoon of Memorial Day. When I reported this to my father, he said, no. I went to bed crying my heart out. I was so disappointed. He came to our kids' room, got me up, sat me down on the toilet, sat on the side of the bathtub in front of me, and began to show me what a wonderful thing it was to be a human being with an opposable thumb. A thumb that can come together with any of the other fingers of your hand. He began to narrate with demonstrations what could be done with your thumb. I was fascinated and went back to bed and directly to sleep. The next day after breakfast, our family, all of us, set out for the cemetery to decorate the graves of loved ones. Dad called it Decoration Day. He believed in honoring family ancestors and recognizing the sacrifice of soldiers in wars, even though he was a pacifist. After these activities, we came home in plenty of time for the football game. Many years later, I worked with him for a short time as a researcher and lobbyist. He taught me the role of a creativity that works within limits. For example, testifying at a Senate committee meeting, he offered to submit in writing, to submit his written testimony to be entered into the congressional record as read, rather than to, and you, then he used his time that he would have spent reading his statement to answer questions from committee members. Then he would take the congressional record in hand and go to the legislative assistants of the various congressmen or to the congressmen or senators themselves and point out certain things in his statement that he wanted them to see personally. And I thought that was a very creative way to do that. He avoided the tedium of such a presentation and answered questions that people actually had. Sometimes he would send me on an errand with a congressional record to answer questions like that. Another feature of his advocacy was a love for even his enemies, though he told me that he had no enemies, only opponents. He believed in the democratic process, claiming, I can still hear him saying in the car driving home from the office, that the good thing about democracy is that nothing important could happen unless almost everybody wanted it. This required embracing everybody he could for wilderness preservation. He especially liked this well-known quote from Edwin Markham's poem, Outwitted. He drew a circle that shut me out. Heretic, rebel, a thing to flout. But love and I had the wit to win. We drew a safe circle and took him in. In 1961, the Wilderness Bill passed in the Senate 78-8. The votes in the House were also in place to pass it. Chairman Wayne Aspinall of the Interior and Insular Affairs Committee refused to bring to the floor of the House the measure, even though it had been ordered, reported out by his committee. This, my father wrote in the Encyclopedia of Britannica, Book of the Year for 1963. My father and other proponents had no success in circumventing the chairman's refusal. They had to start all over in the next Congress. Nevertheless, when in 1962, Dad learned that Aspinall was ill in the hospital, he wrote the legislator a letter in longhand offering him for his recovery, quote, best wishes and my prayers, hoping that he would, quote, soon be back with us. When Dad died in May of 1964, before he could see the passage of the Wilderness Act, Mr. Aspinall came to the viewing at the funeral home and told me how much he admired my father. I mentioned my parents concerned about family solidarity. A high value of wilderness for them was as an arena for family solidarity. The project began at home. Throughout the year, we took walks in the woods, along the C&L Canal, on Plumber's Island, and other places, especially the Washington Biological Field Club's Plumber's Island, of which he was a member. But I think he thought the real key to family solidarity was not just wilderness tramping, but wilderness camping. In 1947, he and Mom bought a cabin on the edge of what is now the Siamese Pond Wilderness Area in the Adirondack Mountains of New York. There we vacationed and took frequent hikes and camping trips in wild areas for decades. Even now, three generations of family gather at our cabin most summers in August. Dad's great plan was to write a book called Family Camping in the Wilderness, suggesting his prioritizing of the family and his seeing the wilderness as of great value for families. Family solidarity again. I put a little book out there on the table as you come in the building. That is the publication of my mother's journal for this trip, and there are pictures in that there that can you can look at if you're interested. As part of this project, he and Mom organized a set of wilderness adventures beginning in the 9th of July, 1956, and extending into the school year until mid-September. After auto camping through Pennsylvania, New York, and Canada, we started our true wilderness camping in Minnesota and Ontario, canoeing what is now the Boundary Waters Canoe Area Wilderness. I was 18 years old that summer and could share in the driving, packing, and other chores, especially those that involved carrying heavy loads. For this canoe excursion, I was assigned to portage a canoe weighing 84 pounds. Once when I got it settled on my shoulders with paddles nestled into the sweatshirt girdling my neck, a bumblebee crawled out of the folds of the sweatshirt and stung me unceremoniously on my neck. This contributed to my love of wilderness. At the end of the canoe trip, I recorded in my diary, we all had to keep diaries, quote, this strenuous activity is thrilling because it gives one the feeling of going through somewhat the same hardships of the pioneers, Indians, and voyageurs. Just think, I ended, we traveled miles and miles on our own. I also wrote, one of the main things needed for trips such as ours, in order for them to be successful, is somebody to tell the story of them. So thank you for listening. After the Boundary Waters, we went to now this designated Cloud Peak Wilderness area in Wyoming for a week-long pack trip, riding horses and walking. It was a fisherman's paradise. At Cliff Lake, my brother and I fished for a while and caught 17 beautiful mountain brook trout. Just one such of many catches on that trip. We traveled next to Montana and the Bob Marshall Wilderness to go for almost a week with some wilderness enthusiasts on a walking trip while horses carried our dunnage. On one of those days, I remember walking 18 or 22 miles or so, my journal ambiguously recorded, along with another trip evaluation, it was the best trip I have ever seen. It was the best trip I have ever been on. Two experiences in the Bob Marshall made it very special for me. That is long term. The amazing Sun River Valley, a wild river valley in its primitive and untrammeled condition. I hope it will be there for my great-grandchildren, along with our own Allegheny River wilderness. It's rare to have a river valley in wilderness because they were the fit first things settled. The second experience requires a story and gives you another glimpse of the person my father was. On the first day in the Bob Marshall wilderness, I was very sick in my stomach and was virtually crawling along the trail. Way behind the others, I came across my father resting. He had had a heart attack in 1952 and could not keep up with everybody. We were on the same vulnerable page. He asked me how I was feeling, but instead of referring to my case of Montezuma's revenge, I told him about my main source of pain. I left Hinesville, Maryland, our home, and my love, Ann Harrington, for this long trip. I had written her several times, and at stopping points given to her ahead of time, I received letters from her. But our family plan was to let me off at Greenville College in Illinois on our way home. So I figured I would not see her again until Christmas. She was going to Penn State University, and I worried she might meet someone else there. Dad replied simply, I'll do my best to see that you get to see her before you both leave for college. I don't remember what I said immediately, but I know that after that promise, in the remaining days of our trips together, I never mentioned it. I did not know whether I would see Ann again before college, but I knew that Dad would do his best to see if it could happen, because he never forgot a promise or a threat. I felt immediately healed. The final two trips were two Sierra Club high trips, one in a wild portion of Grand Teton National Park in Wyoming, and the other, the Glacier Peak Wilderness National Park in Washington. When we finished our trip, in the Glacier Peak Wilderness area as a family, we visited Irving and Nell Clark in Seattle, activists of the Wilderness Society's inner circle. When we got there, Dad handed me an airplane ticket to fly to Washington National Airport, where Ann would meet me and take me to her house until a bus would take me to Greenville, Illinois. I had caught 3 cutthroat trout from a high enough mountain lake that I was able to wrap them with snow in my poncho, then in my sleeping bag, then stuff the bundle in my pack and walk out of the glorious presence of these magnificent mountains to our car, which took my family and me to Seattle. There at the Clark's house, I undid my bundle and rewrapped my fish in my poncho and sleeping bag with canned ice for the flight east. I found that the shortest way to a mother-in-law's heart is fresh trout. I married her daughter 3 years later. Our 55th anniversary is tomorrow. My mother wrote me. My mother wrote in her journal about our family's wilderness camping that summer. On this trip that we have just completed, I have had moments of supreme happiness. If you knew how hard she worked, you would be amazed. So now, let me urge you, look carefully at these pictures of Pennsylvania and other wilderness vistas, and support a citizen's wilderness proposal for Pennsylvania's Allegheny National Forest. And also, think seriously about camping with those you love in these wild and wonderful areas. Somewhere, Howard Zahniser will be smiling. Thank you.